Hi, everybody. I'm Andrew Lowe, a professor of finance at the MIT Sloan School of Management and a principal investigator at the MIT Computer Science and AI Lab, and I'm looking forward to answering your questions. Let's take the first one. How can large language models efficiently analyze financial reports to extract key insights, such as identifying risks, opportunities, and emerging trends? Large language models are actually designed to be able to read plain text and be able to digest and summarize them. Earnings reports, financial statements, these are the kind of things that large language models can now read and be able to generate very, very short and pithy summaries to be able to focus on things like risks, opportunities, and other issues. In the financial sector, we use certain keywords to be able to highlight risks and opportunities so that there are automatic tags that large language models can figure out very, very quickly. Large language models will have a huge impact on the life of financial analysts because their job day in and day out is to be able to read these reports, and they can now do that using these tools in a much faster and more accurate way. Can LLMs identify subtle market patterns and anomalies that may elude human analysts? The answer is yes, they can. But they can also identify anomalies that don't exist. In other words, hallucinate. And this is one of the challenges that we have to deal with LLMs. Right now, we know that they're very capable of being able to identify some really interesting patterns, but at the same time, they can also identify things that aren't there and require humans to engage in additional oversight. Now, by the way, humans are not perfect either, and we are prone to hallucinate on occasion. Paul Samuelson famously said that economists have predicted 5 out of the last 3 recessions. And I think that's part of what he was getting at. We need to think about how we can make ourselves more accurate. So the combination of humans and LLMs could actually be the sweet spot of being able to produce really accurate forecasts for all sorts of economic phenomena. How can we build trust in financial advice and decisions provided by LLMs? And what strategies can be employed to maintain human oversight and control? Now, this is a really interesting one because it gets at an issue that my collaborators and I have been working on for the last several months. And we think we have an approach, but it'll be several years before we come to it. And the problem that we're studying is the issue of trust. How do we get LLMs to be trusted, and specifically in the context of financial advice? So in that domain, we actually have a concept that is known as fiduciary duty. And this really gets at the heart of trust. In the financial sector, a fiduciary is somebody who puts your interests ahead of his or her own. So for example, if you have a financial advisor, that financial advisor owes you a fiduciary duty, meaning that when they give you advice about how to manage your money, they have to be thinking first and foremost about your welfare, as opposed to lining their own pockets with commissions that might come out of the kind of trades that they would do on your behalf. How do we get an LLM to become a fiduciary? How do we get it to be a trusted financial advisor to you? Our approach is to think about how this happens in the industry with human financial advisors. How do human advisors become fiduciaries? Well, for one thing, they have a code of ethics, so they have to follow certain rules. But more importantly, they have to follow a large number of financial regulations, laws that we put in place in order to protect consumers. And at one point, I remember studying these laws because I had to take a securities exam in order to be involved in a particular kind of a financial institution. And this exam, called the Series 65, tests you on your knowledge not only of financial analysis, but also of the regulatory infrastructure that guides all of us in the industry. And so after spending hours and hours reading all of these rules and being frustrated that I was forced to memorize these things, it finally dawned on me where these things were coming from. The historical body of case law that has been used to guide lawyers, regulators, and consumers as to what they can and cannot do, that is a fossil record of all of the ways that one human has decided to be able to try to take advantage of another human and ultimately got caught and prosecuted successfully for it. So if we trained LLMs, not just with the body of financial knowledge, but the full case law history of all of the various different lawsuits that have been filed against certain bad actors in the financial system, if we do all of that, we then can train LLMs to become fiduciaries. We believe that we're still a few years away from something that the SEC and lawyers would agree would be a fiduciary, but we at least know the direction that we're going, and we're very excited to be able to go that route and ultimately produce a piece of software that can be fully trusted by humans. What role could LLMs play in automating and streamlining risk assessment processes for banks and financial institutions, and how should these systems be governed? So this is also a great question, because that's one of the most important features that financial institutions have to carry out. It's risk management. Risk management has two parts, in my view. The first part is a quantitative part, and that's actually relatively easy to automate. Computing things like value at risk and scenario analyses and worst loss scenarios, all of those things can now be done pretty much at a push of a button, and are being done by all the big financial institutions. What is much more difficult is the second set of tasks, and that is taking all of those numbers and putting that into a narrative that can be given to a risk manager, to a policymaker, to a customer, so that they understand what the implications of those numbers are for their own personal circumstances. Imagine that the stock market just went down by 15% today, and that means that your portfolio of bonds are now in trouble because the stock market has gone down and there's a concern that the Fed is going to have to step in, and everybody is worried about defaults across various different kinds of scenarios, and you're holding a bunch of corporate bonds that are risky to begin with, but in today's scenario, it's a lot worse. What do you do about it? An LLM could analyze the numerical data instantaneously and then weave that into a narrative which says, perhaps, today equity markets are down by quite a bit. That means the Fed's going to step in. There's going to be panic among a bunch of investors. And that means that certain assets will sell off and other assets will become much more valuable. If you're holding corporate bonds, that is likely to get hit hard. Treasury bills are going to do really well, but I would wait for another 3 to 5 weeks before you do anything dramatic, because over the course of history, if you looked at similar situations, these kinds of moves are temporary and things will normalize. That's the kind of narrative that an LLM can provide that is not available when you're just looking at a whole table of numbers. So, over time, I suspect that LLMs will get much better at weaving those narratives and also being able to describe some of the weaknesses in their narratives and where you might want to use your own personal judgment to make a call for your own portfolio. So I think we're not that far away from the use of LLMs for risk management, and I'm hoping that that will get everybody to focus on the right kind of risks that are relevant to them. How can the natural language processing capabilities of LLMs be used to perform sentiment analysis on financial news, social media, and other textual data to inform trading and investment decisions? So typically, we believe that financial markets are moved by two things, fear and greed. Now, that's the Wall Street trader's perspective. If you're asking an economist, it's all about the numbers, right? The bottom line is it's both. It's the numbers, but it's how we interpret the numbers, and that's where sentiment comes in. So the idea behind sentiment analysis is to try to understand how human emotion is going to react to the numbers. And over the course of the last several decades, there's been a lot written on human behavior, psychology, and the ability for us to manage our emotions in very, very difficult financial circumstances. obviously, most of us have trouble doing so because we are all hardwired to engage in the fight or flight response. When we are threatened, we will react in a very predictable way physiologically, which is great if you're being chased by a saber-toothed tiger on the plains of the African savannah 100,000 years ago, doesn't work so well on the floor of the New York Stock Exchange today. So sentiment analysis is an attempt to try to look at the various different financial indicators to get a sense of whether or not the market is overreacting or underreacting. And I think this is where LLMs will have a field day because they're going to be able to look at the numbers. But more importantly, they're going to be able to read the literature of what's being written at that very moment by news sources that are freaking the rest of us out. When the news stations tell us, is there something in milk that could be hurting your infants more at 11, you're going to feel compelled to watch that news story at 11 o'clock. So we are very easily moved by those kinds of threats. And so LLMs will be very good at picking up those kinds of threats and coordinating the analysis of the language with the numbers to be able to produce sentiment analysis. In fact, I wouldn't be surprised if certain hedge funds were already using LLMs to be able to detect these kinds of patterns and start making use of them. The hope is that the typical retail investor, the rest of us consumers, will have access to those tools soon. Okay, next question. How can we mitigate bias in LLMs for financial applications? And what other ethical considerations like algorithmic transparency and accountability should be prioritized? So the first thing to note is that LLMs absolutely do have biases. And I know this because my students and I documented that in a paper we wrote recently, looking at hiring decisions that an LLM might make when confronted with a variety of different candidates. So it definitely suffers from gender bias in a variety of different contexts. And it's not surprising because what are LLMs reflecting? They're reflecting the sum total of the literature that they're using as inputs to be trained. The first step in dealing with bias is to document it. We need to understand, depending on the nature of the LLM, how it's trained, other supplements that we use with it, we have to understand exactly what those biases are. We have to quantify them. Once we quantify them, then we can start asking the question, how do we decide to change the biases to make it more appropriate for the purpose at hand? So that's a question that requires domain-specific knowledge. In certain areas, the biases may be very small. In other areas, the biases may be huge. So for every single application, I believe that we need to think carefully about the implicit biases in the LLM that we're using. And once we document that, to be able to then start engaging in recoding or adding various different supplements, retrieval augmented guides, RAGs that would actually lean against those kinds of biases to the degree that we wish. Over time, we need to understand how these biases are changing. They change across time, across culture, across country. So understanding just exactly what these LLMs are doing is something that is going to be a prerequisite to us being able to put any of these things into practice. You have to measure before you can manage. Can LLMs be used to enhance the detection and prevention of financial fraud? I think the answer to this is unambiguously, absolutely yes. Right now, there are a number of machine learning tools that are already being used by the SEC and other agencies to identify potential fraud. A long time ago, it was suggested by a mathematician that there are certain statistical properties that have to exist among a table of numbers. And so if you see a departure from that statistical regularity, that's an example of fraud. So using these kinds of distributions, already we can detect certain types of fraud. But now with LLMs, with more sophisticated ways of processing natural language and numbers together, we can actually do even better. So there's no doubt in my mind that this is going to be a tremendously powerful tool. The dark side of this is that with these LLMs, we can also create fraud that is harder to detect. For example, imagine prompting your LLM by asking it to take a look at your tax returns and suggest ways of putting in certain kinds of deductions that will give you a much lower tax bill, and even if they break the rules, to do so in a way that makes it virtually impossible to detect by a typical IRS auditor. Now, imagine if you gave that prompt to an LLM, and imagine if it could actually deliver on that request. That's the danger. And one of the reasons why I think we're in an arms race between the regulators and the perpetrators, and one of the reasons why I believe that we ought to increase the budgets of regulatory authorities, because they need to have the same type of equipment and sophistication to be able to address these concerns so that they can stay ahead of the fraudsters. In what ways can LLMs assist in the development and testing of more sophisticated trading algorithms? I believe that they're actually already being used for just that purpose. So it used to be the case that machine learning algorithms really had to be focused on the specific feature that you were giving it to be able to detect patterns in financial data. And that's really what trading algorithms are. It's really just pattern matching so that you can predict what's going to happen tomorrow and trade today to take advantage of that prediction. But now, imagine being able to make those predictions based not just on numerical data, but on textual data, and to be able to combine the two, to be able to create this kind of a sentiment analysis score, and be able to understand how it is that certain kinds of language yield predictions that will ultimately come to pass in financial stock prices, bond prices, and other instruments. So large language models now can analyze lots of different sources of text, including news. News is one of the really key aspects of financial markets. Markets are always reacting to current information. And the information does not necessarily have to be accurate for financial markets to react. They will react to rumor in many cases just as quickly as they'll react to substantive, true information. And so large language models can combine the kind of information across various different news sources and distill it into a single prediction, which is, will the asset go up or down in price tomorrow? I believe that more sophisticated methods of prediction are possible, but the challenge is to come up with the correct prompts to make those predictions and then to be able to deal with the issue of hallucination. So that's one of the reasons why hedge funds now are experimenting with these large language models, and why those of you who are interested in having a career in financial analysis, I would urge you to start playing around with LLMs for exactly this purpose. What regulatory and compliance considerations should be addressed when deploying LLMs in this field? Well, I mentioned that there's an arms race going on between the regulators and the fraudsters. And I think that that's something that we really need to consider over the course of the next few years as the pace of innovation gets faster and faster on the side of the practitioners. We need to give regulators the tools to be able to fight this kind of a battle. And unless we pass legislation to help them, I think it's going to be a very one-sided race. Let me give you an example of one piece of legislation that I think we have to consider. Data is an incredibly powerful currency in this business. And so who controls the data? If I'm a consumer and I put my data at the disposal of a particular vendor that's providing a service for me, does that vendor have the right to use that for any purpose whatsoever, including purposes that are detrimental to me? So there's legislation that needs to be formulated as to who has the rights to the data, and if vendors are making use of customer data, what can and what can they not do with that data? We need to pass legislation to make this clear so that we can allow the data to be used in broader and more effective ways while at the same time protecting the interests of those who need protection. So I think that's the biggest set of issues right now, is that the regulators don't have all of the tools that they need, and they don't have the budget that they need to be able to deal with these kind of issues. We need to bite the bullet and make an investment in our regulatory infrastructure to deal with this brave new world that we're entering.